share some of our work carried out in BRC. And the motivation behind my coming here is, or to my giving the talk here, is to motivate some of you to carry out some of your experiments in BRC, in our facilities. I show you why you should do some experiments in BRC. Now, I come from solid state physics division. I guess some of you have been in BRC, and what you see in the backdrop is the campus. The idea is to study frustrated compounds with neutron diffraction. Now, as I quote somebody, some amount of frustration is good. Yes, I mean, many of us are at different levels of frustration. In physics, it is definitely true. It adds variety. Why, I say. Now, there are two key things in this. One is the frustration, and the other is the neutron diffraction technique. I talk about it, in the context of manganites and the multiferroic behavior in these compounds. So it will be in this backdrop of manganites and multiferroic. What is the frustration leading to? It is a key, it plays a key role in multiferroic behavior. I tell you why. And a neutron diffraction technique, as many of you have or know, that it gives you the spin arrangement in solids. Okay, there's no other technique which allows you to do that. XMCD to a limited extent. It does not really, it just measures the polarization, but a diffraction is a sure shot technique, just like X-ray diffraction. A neutron diffraction gives you the magnetic structure, and X-ray or and together with it the chemical structure. So it is an ideal tool to study a multiferroic behavior where you have both the lattice displacement as well as the magnetic part. Now, okay, some amount of advertisement for the host institute, BRC. And it is a multidisciplinary research institute where there's a number of activities. There's a research reactor. This is the only one which is functioning right now, Dhruva. The Cirrus is down. And all the experiments right now, solid state physics experiments, are carried out in Dhruva reactor. And this is the view graph, or you are seeing the photograph of the research reactor hall inside, where all the experimental tools or experimental beam lines are there. We run the National Facility for Neutron Beam Research, under which, Then you don't see me. This is the reactor hall, and where the various beam lines are there. And so we are open to both in-house and collaborative research. Many of you have carried out experiments like Pratap, Ashish, the previous speaker, and some of you in the audience do. Now, these are the various, you don't see it, but there are various instruments looking at various length scales as well as the time scales. The various instruments are to probe the various length scales and time scales in solid state physics. You have inelastic as well as elastic experiments. The most functional and the most used experiments, of course, are the diffractometers and the small angle instrument. Together with it, right now, these days, it is also the reflectivity experiments that are very popular. And this is the instrument that you see. This is the powder diffractometer that we have. Of course, this doesn't say anything except that we have a temperature facility where you can vary the temperature from almost from 2 Kelvin to 1000 and above. And we have also a provision to put in a magnetic field. There's an existing cryomagnet, but we have not installed it yet. But very soon it will be available. But as against a magnetometer where you put a magnetic, where you necessarily need to have a magnet to study a magnetic compound, a neutron diffraction or a magnetic neutron diffraction experiment need not have a magnetic field. This is the bottom line, that you need not have a magnetic field and still get the entire spin structure. Okay, in a magnetometer, you necessarily have to put a magnetic field to get or to obtain the magnetic moment, for the reasons you know that. And okay, this is not required, this is the instrument. Now, coming to the development in this field of magnetism. The magnetic ordering was way back known to even the Greeks from FE3 or 4 studies. The theory for antiferromagnets was developed in 1930. The first experiment by Scholl on the neutron diffraction or getting the magnetic structure was carried out somewhere in 1949. After that, variety of systems have been studied, very complex systems, whatever you name it. Now, there are certain systems which are studied where the lattice periodicity actually restricts long-range ordering, or there are systems where a triangular lattice, for instance, which prohibits long-range ordering, or you cannot have two interactions together. You cannot have a long-range order in this kind of a system where there is a triangular lattice. So in this kind of system, what is the problem? You either cannot have a ferromagnetic or an antiferromagnetic interaction at a time. You have to have both interactions, and this is leading to this frustration in this kind of a spin. It leads to what is called the geometric frustration because of the lattice. It is different from a spin glass where you have two competing interactions, J1 and J2, for instance. Here, it is the lattice which is prohibiting an long-range order to establish. And what is the frustration doing? As a result of the frustration, you have number of possibilities. See, all these six are possible states from the same triangular lattice. This is, as a result of it, you have a degeneracy. And this degeneracy is susceptible to a variety of perturbations. And this is what is leading this field to be a very interesting as well as challenging. Coming back to this one, that what you have is if you have a disordered system and a frustration, you get a spin glass. This is all many of us have studied. If you don't have a disorder, and if you don't have frustration, you have what you have, a long-range ordering, right? Antiferromagnetism, ferromagnetism, you do not have a disorder, neither you have frustration in the system. The moment you have frustration only and no disorder, so these are without disorder but frustration only arising from the geometry, you have the geometrical frustration. Now, this frustration can be observed in variety of systems. Kagome, triangular, pyrochlore, many of you are studying this. Sorry? Yes. We show you also that is right. I mean, it is also a spin liquid without a disorder. That is, we show you a spin liquid signatures. I don't show you the time correlation. I show you the spatial correlation. Now, we have been focusing, I mean, we means few of us in BRs in solid state physics division, been focusing on manganites for quite some time. In RMnO3 compounds, many of you who are studying it may be familiar with, this is the nice phase diagram that you have. A system, the lower the lower Z ones, which has an orthorhombic symmetry, and the higher ones have the hexagonal ones. So the higher Z values or the lower ionic radii. So anything above holmium has a hexagonal face. Anything below that is orthorhombic. You can stretch this orthorhombic face to the ones with holmium, erbium, etc., provided it is made in a very non-ambient conditions. You require a high pressure synthesis to obtain holmium manganese HMnO3 in an orthorhombic phase. Now, what is of interest in this orthorhombic phase? The orthorhombic phase, if you see the lower R compounds, they are all A-type antiferromagnet. The lower R compounds are all an antiferromagnet or A-type antiferromagnet. When you go to the compounds with terbium, holmium, etc., you find that system exhibits an incommensurate structure or a spiral structure or an incommensurate structure. So suddenly the system, which was A-type antiferromagnet, undergoes, exhibits an incommensurate structures. Now you must have seen that structures with, the TbMnO3 kind compounds, which also show a spin-driven polarizations. This is important that the multiferroic behavior in these compounds are not as in barium titanate, where the lattice distortion takes place, but these are spin-driven multiferroicity. These are much more subtle. These are much more of a challenge to study. Now, it is found that these compounds, terbium, holmium, etc., exhibit in orthorhombic phase, exhibit the spin-driven ferroelectricity, and the polarizations are sometimes very, very large. In the case of holmium, you can see it goes up to all the way up to 4,000. It's very giant. In the case of terbium, it's small, but nevertheless driven by magnetism. Now, what is of interest? Why magnetism and ferroelectricity are of such a challenge? What is it that is challenging to in this community? Now, we know that polarization and magnetization have different in the sense the polarization undergoes an inversion with a change of, or especially invariant it is, polarization, whereas it is time invariant, whereas magnetization is specially invariant, whereas it undergoes a time inversion symmetry operation. So a coupling is possible. They are totally incompatible, but when it is possible to couple them, only when they vary in space and time. So you can couple magnetization and polarization only when they are varying in space and time. Now, how do you bring about this? You can bring about this if you take a linear chain of spins. Suppose it is a ferromagnet. You have all arranged spins, all arranged in a particular manner, with a near neighbor interaction J or J prime, whatever. Now, if you introduce a next nearest neighbor interaction J, so which is different from J prime, now you bring in this earlier ferromagnetic spin chains into a spiral order. So the idea behind this is that for a spiral order to come into the play, you require a existence of two kinds of interaction, ferromagnet as well as an antiferromagnetic interaction, which comes about when you have systems with frustrated magnetism, and this is, it breaks the both the symmetries, the time as well as the spatial. Now, in case of an orthorhombic system, there are two kinds of theories which actually explains this kind of behavior, which are called the spin current model or the spin current and the DM interactions, which are explains this behavior. What it says is you have two non-collinear spins connected by a ligand, oxygen atom, and you require an interaction which displaces this oxygen atom perpendicular to the spins. Now, this is what is actually explained by these two models. What we are studying is the hexagonal systems, which are fairly different from either of these two models. It is not explained by this, but in this model, the polarization that you see are very, very small. The polarization that you observe experimentally as well as theoretically, these are very small. These are very difficult to detect from a normal diffraction experiment. It requires a very large resolution instrument, which are, I mean, you can detect a little bit from EXAFs also. Now, in hexagonal magnets, we have invested our time in a system with YMNO3. I mean, I show you some of the results with YMNO3. Why YMNO3? Because here, at least the magnetism is all from manganese. Yttrium is non-magnetic. It is a type 1 multiferroic, where the ferroelectricity is fairly well separated from the magnetic ordering. And the ferroelectricity is driven by the displacement of the yttrium ions and the MnO5 buckling, of course. The transition temperature is around 950. The magnetic transition temperature is around 75K. Now, you don't expect a coupling between these two when there are two so extreme cases of ferroelectricity and magnetic ordering temperature. Now, we find that despite this vast difference, we show you that there are still coupling which exists at the onset of magnetic ordering in this kind of systems. And we try to tell you what we observe in these systems. In YMNO3, of course, the Y and Mn are in a plane, in a 2D plane. You can think of it as a 2D plane, well separated by each other with yttrium layers. And it has a very large frustration parameter. Now, the frustration parameter is governed by, I mean, typically it is given by this theta by Tn, which is normally for a normal antiferromagnet, it should have been 1 or close to 1. But in this case, you have a large deviation from the Curie-Weiss behavior. That is how you get this value. It is actually, this frustration behavior is coming from the layered magnetism that it exhibits. It is a two-dimensional arrangement of manganese spins, with J in plane far, far greater than out of plane, purely coming from the spacing between the manganese are very, very large along the C-axis. This along the C-axis, it is about 13 angstrom, and about in the A-axis, it is about 5. So you can easily see that there is a huge anisotropy in the structure, which results in the large in-plane and out-of-plane anisotropy. This is very large. It is the numbers I think I have written somewhere. Okay. The ferroelectricity in the paraelectric phase, you can see that the yttrium ions are of equidistance to each other. This is the paraelectric phase above 950. And in the ferroelectric phase, there is a displacement of the yttrium. It has nothing to do with the manganese here, it is only the yttrium sites which gets displaced. And the ferroelectricity arises from both the bipyramidal MnO5 displacement as well as the Y3 ions. And it is the type 1 multiferroic as defined in the literature. Now, if you see its magnetization curve, there is very little signature that it is an antiferromagnet. You can see that it is more or less behaving like a very good Curie-wise behavior. If you see its 1 over chi, it is not a linear behavior. It is a very nonlinear behavior, and from which you actually get the theta by Tn very large. It shows that it is a frustration. This is the first signature that it shows a frustration behavior. Of course, there are other things to look for. For instance, the magnetization that you would get because of this frustration behavior would be far less than what you would expect for a normal Mn3 plus ion. So these two signatures are very, very crucial. Now, in this case, you have theta by Tn is about 6. The only signature that actually we found was from the specific heat measurement, that it gives a nice lambda anomaly at the transition temperature. Now, when you do a neutron diffraction experiment, of course, you will see that there are sure shot signatures of an antiferromagnetism in this compound. And as Pratap was saying, that we will show also some evidence of existence of a spin liquid state in this compound between the transition temperature and some high temperature regime. Well above the Tn, it's in a spin liquid state. Now, this frustrated state actually is also subject to any kind of doping, either in the yttrium site or in the manganese site. If you dope it on the yttrium site by a magnetic ion, then the 2D behavior is suppressed. And this is what we find, that when you dope it with any magnetic ion at the yttrium site, straight away you can see the frustration parameter is now becomes very close to 1, which you would expect for a normal antiferromagnet. The reason we try to bring in, it exhibits a large magnetoelastic coupling at around Tn. The volume, there is a large jump in the volume, or there is a large volume anomaly at Tn, which is again suppressed if you try to do some doping in this compound. So there is a magnetic anomaly in the volume, and there is also an anomaly if you measure the dielectric constant. What is plotted here is the dielectric constant as a function of temperature. You will see that there is a large jump of the dielectric constant coinciding with the transition temperature. Now, this is a little bit suppressed if you try to dope it. So it is a function of the manganese layering. And we find that this delta E, if you can call it, the delta E here is actually proportional to magnetization square. So now this magnetization is the antiferromagnetic site moment. Now, from a diffraction experiment alone in an antiferromagnet, you would get what is known as the antiferromagnetic moment. You don't get this antiferromagnetic moment from a normal the best spin magnetometer that you have. So if you wish to study an antiferromagnet, there is no other way than coming for neutron diffraction experiment at the moment. So we find that this excess dielectric constant suppression is correlated with magnetization. Actually, it is quadratically coupled with magnetization. It is magnetization square, and it follows the free energy. It can be obtained from the free energy that it should be so, that delta E should be proportional to m square, as expected from the Landau theory. Now, the question was, what is happening here? It is far away from the ferroelectric transition temperature. So the we from our experiment we did not get the clue. This is an experiment done at another source at LLB France, where they have all instruments have their own some amount of limitations. What they found is that the manganese here, actually position of the manganese changes in this lattice at the transition temperature. So the manganese position, which was roughly around 0.33, actually has undergone a slight change at the transition temperature. So it is not so a displacement of manganese from its position is what is causing the magnetoelastic coupling at the transition temperature of this compound. Of course, from our experiments we are unable to get this. So a typically neutron diffraction experiment does give how many? We have 1 or 2 minutes. I can finish it off. Yeah. So a typical diffraction experiment tells you that the unit cell here is the same as the chemical cell. That's what the propagation vector 0, 0, 0. And this is a typical diffraction experiment. When you cool from room temperature to lower temperature, you get enhancement in intensity of some of the reflections. And then the problem with diffraction experiment is that, unlike other experiments, you here have to model the diffraction experiment. So you have to assume a certain spin or a certain structure, and then you have to build on that. Now, for your guidance, there are group theory methods which tells you that what are the spin structures that are possible. In this particular space group, there are 6 representations that are possible. I show you 4 one-dimensional possibilities, and here the red and blue indicates the 2 layers. And so these are the 4 possibilities of spin structures, actually 6, and from here we model our thing and we find from our experiments that it is either gamma 1 or gamma 3 representation that best describes our experiment. Now this is a problem for experiment, that it is, these are homometric structures. That means you cannot distinguish between gamma 1 and gamma 3, because this gives you the identical intensities. Therefore, you have to resort to other experiments like second harmonic generation experiments to actually decouple these two. And what is found from those is the gamma 3 representation, which appropriately describes this thing. And the spin structures actually are susceptible to dopants. It goes from being very collinear to a very, you can see the structures are very different as soon as you are doping. So I go quickly to another one where you put in rare earth dopant. So you dope at the rare earth site. If you dope at the rare earth site, what happens is you get a magnetic moment also at the rare earth. Now, as a result of the magnetic moment at the rare earth site, you have this breaking of the layer, MNO spin systems, and therefore you have a kind of a three-dimensional structure, and that is why you see in our previous experiments where the frustration parameter was suppressed with doping of rare earths at the yttrium site. So, and just one last thing, I mean, this is the signature for the short range ordering in these solids, that when you do a diffraction at room temperature and low temperature, and then you subtract it, and then you see the diffuse structure at the transition temperature, and which is actually present all the way up to, here I have shown about 100, it is also present even up to 200 Kelvin. So you see a diffuse structure all the way up. You can model this as we have done and try to extract various parameters from there. Okay, I finish with that. Okay, thank you so much.